Welcome to Magic Gathering Strat. I'm Brennon, your lovable host. Along with me, as always, are my two co-hosts, Sam, the Vault Boy Hunter. Say hello, Sam.
Hello, everybody.
And Dan, the fan of history.
Hello!
Hello, Dan.
Hi.
All right. It's that time of the week again, the time we all look forward to. That's right, episode 39, One Land Spy. Why are you so hard?
I did not hear about this title before the show. I thought we were going for like week two of the Pauper Gauntlet or something.
Hey, we'll get to the Pauper Gauntlet. Don't you worry about that.
But, don't you worry your pretty little head.
But yeah. One land spy. There's so many decisions. Anyway, we'll talk about Standard Pauper, our weeks in review, and the Gauntlet. That's right, Dan. We will not ever forget the Gauntlet.
Nice.
For however many months it goes, and then we're just going to be waiting for the next one. So let's get started. Kind of a short Standard Pauper week. Unfortunately, no SPDC.
None. They had hosting issues.
Yeah.
Dr. Chris was doing something and Roberto couldn't host. And they don't have a third backup.
It seems a little unreasonable for them to have three people.
No, I mean, for a free event hosted on Sunday afternoons.
Exactly.
The fact that this is the first one that they've completely missed in how many weeks? I can't remember the last time there was a Sunday without an event that wasn't like in between seasons. So
right, but you know what this does? This now makes my OCD calm down a little bit because the numbers of the events will be the same again.
Oh, hidden advantage for Brennon.
Yeah.
I'm happy for you.
Thank you. Thank you. I hate having two different PDC event numbers. But I'm afraid that means there's no winter overview. Nothing. It's not there.
Mono nothing.
Yeah. This is the deck that always wins. The deck you don't play. All right. Well, let's talk about MPDC 3107. This today, December 7th, 13 players, 9 reported, but that's probably just an affect of when I put this together. What do we have? First place. What is that mess? Look at that. A Golgari deck came in first.
What?
Yeah.
That's a thing?
Apparently. Then, Grixis Control came in second. Deck Not Found, very intriguing. Let me see if that's come up yet, because it wasn't last time.
No, still Deck Not Found.
Damn it. And then, Highlands by Yonderkind.
What is an Unholy Hunger?
Unholy Hunger? That's that enchant. Oh, wait. It's there. It's there now. Wait, what is this? Wait, hold on. No, it's not. I lack the ability to click. What the heck? Why is it all messed up? It's not listed at all. Hold on. Refresh. Let's try that again.
Secret.
There it is. F5. Look into it. Okay. Let's check out. What the heck is this? GB Midrange. There we go. Check it out. It's Tajuru Stalwart. I will give you $1 if you can tell me what that card does right now. Counting down. 5, 4, 3.
Is it the +1/+1 to all creatures if you play an ally? No, it's the guy. +1/+1 for each colorless. Yeah. It costs 3 mana. It's 0/1.
Well, folks.
So it can be 3/4/4.
It can be a 3.
That's a strange inclusion in a 2-color deck.
Yeah. You have Bloodfell Caves. Oops. And Rugged Highlands. And one mountain.
So you can get out to 3 colors.
Yeah.
Which is kind of where, you know, the optimum is for it. Converge, sorry. Domain, Converge, whatever.
But why did it show up as only... Oh, I know why it showed up as only... But he said... I don't know. That's weird. But anyway, it is not a card that we see very much on this channel.
Not yet.
It has the wrong name.
What's that?
It's the right deck, but it's the wrong title. And
Oh, wow. Oops. My bad. The right title is... Coming up quick as I can.
Sorry.
Paste. Look at that. Loves me some copy paste. The only thing I do not like is the fact that we still do not have the new cards. And by new cards, I mean Origins.
Yeah.
That's got to change.
Attending to the databases anymore. So I feel like it's going to be a while. There's only 4 green. No, that's not correct. There's more than 4 green mana. Okay. This is a very dark deck.
Yep. Vulturous Aven, Gurmag, Silumgar Butcher, Nantuko Husk, Dutiful Attendant, Eyeless Watcher, and Elvish Visionary.
I kind of like the Eyeless Watcher Nantuko Husk.
I do too. Eyeless Watcher's fine card with me.
I have to look
me.
Up Eyeless Watcher.
The 1/1.
The 1/1 with 2/1s.
Yeah, the new Kozilek's Predator that's not quite as good.
Captain's Call for...
there you go. Captain's Call for green. Very good. That's actually an excellent description of that card.
Of course, Eldrazi Science are better than 1/1 soldiers.
Oh my god, yeah.
Butcher's Glee is an interesting inclusion. The one match I lost in the double league.
Yeah.
I lost to Butcher's Glee's onto a Gurmag Angler with Teamer Battle Rage.
Holy crap.
Because that got out of control really quick.
Yeah, not much you can do about that. Unless you have removal, somehow, in this format.
I mean, what do you remove a Gurmag Angler with?
Vapor Snag.
Vapor Snag. Good call.
Excellent. I knew I could do it.
Clutch of Karens.
Clutch of Karens. I thought that was Sorcery. Sorcery is an instant.
Yes.
Sorcery.
Whoa. Somebody just moved a car.
No, I moved the table. I'm sorry.
It's okay. Converge. Tajiru Stalwart. There's a 2 and a green. Converge. That's the one.
Yeah, that's what I said.
Yeah.
I hope.
You said 4 mana. You were totally wrong.
No, I meant 3.
You should feel ashamed.
A 4 mana would be horrible.
God, yeah.
4 mana could be a 4/5, though.
For 4 different colors of mana.
Yeah, I think that would be way worse.
Okay. Well, let's move on. Interesting deck. I'm glad to see something a little new, a little inventive.
Grixis Control on the second slot is pretty cool.
What do we have there? PDC? Let me go back. You know, it'd be easier to make multiples of these if they just include all the freaking cards. Yeah. Disowned Ancestor, Gurmag Angler, Worldwind Adept. And then... Which one was not found? Main Deck, Complete Disregard, and Fiery Impulse.
And some Twin Bolt, some Dragon Fodders. That's an interesting deck. I bet he lost twice to the winner.
Yeah, it makes sense. It's a good deck, though.
How many treasure cruises?
3.
All 4.
Those are 4?
All 4. Yeah. Okay.
Well, there you go.
He's doing it right. He's living life like it's intended to be lived.
chock full of Treasure Cruise. If you look at the Highlands deck in MPDC, it only shows 32 cards because there's so many new cards.
Oh my god.
That's the Landfall deck, right?
Yeah, it's the Landfall deck.
Wow, it looked really weird.
Yeah. Snapping Gnarled Predator. Yep.
Rock Smaller and Sure Strike, which have been around for months.
And Mage Ring Bully. Let's not forget that.
Ugh. Man, he either does good with this deck or does really bad with it.
You haven't seen the Landfall Pauper Gauntlet deck yet, have you?
Have you played it yet?
Yeah, I haven't seen it.
Yeah, I played it, but I scheduled it.
Uh-oh. Okay.
That we haven't seen.
Okay, it's gonna be a big surprise.
I mean, one of the
super powerful.
One of the most interesting matches that played against somebody was the Domain Landfall deck. So that was really fun.
The Landfall Pauper Gauntlet deck is by JPH Snake, and it was capable of some resilient aggression.
Really. Because that's the one, that's like the, I only got one of his decks in paper this time. I'll talk about that a little bit later, but I got the Goblins deck because I had most of the pieces, but I did not have most of the pieces of the Landfall deck. Now I'm rethinking my decisions.
It really surprised me.
Okay, well, when I watch it, I could use my supreme YouTube powers and look at it before anyone else.
Yeah, consider it a perk.
A perk, yes. Dun, dun, dun. I get to see it before y'all do. All right, well, let's move on and talk to Mr. Sam. Any announcements, deck updates? What's going on in your life?
Pauper Thursday night.
Hot.
We're going to somewhere Pauper EDH. I'm going to put together a young Pyromancer deck.
Wow.
Yeah, because, I mean, burn to the face with Pyromancer able to come down on turn three and start pumping out tokens.
Sounds good.
I feel like
me.
That's a good way to go, right?
Hey, why not?
Well, no blue is the big reason why not, but I think I can deal with that.
Right, but you got Tormenting Voice, Faithless Looting,
Wild Guess.
Wild Guess, all those crazy ass. Draw, facts. Discard.
Yeah.
Oh, what's the one that you draw two, discard two at random?
Oh, I have no idea. That sounds horrible. I'll have to see if I have any.
You need to look into that.
And let's see. I finished 4-1 in the double league. I finished in 11th.
That was a shame. You thought that 4-1 would be enough.
Yeah, but like I think the top five were all undefeated or something like that.
Bava's in the top eight.
Yeah,
Bava's in the top eight.
I think it was like 3 4-1s or something like that with the best tiebreakers.
Yeah.
That's okay.
The guy
that's
who kicked my ass in the last round, he didn't make it either. But really? I would have. Yeah.
Jeez.
If I had won, I would have made top eight, but I lost.
So
I think once this top eight thing happens, I think Bava wants to come on and talk about his experiences as of late.
That would be awesome.
Would be fun.
Yep. Bava, when you hear this, you can come on anytime. Hell, if you just popped into Skype right now, we'd add you.
Right now.
Is he there? Did he hear us?
No, I don't think he's in the chat. I don't know. I mean, I had a good time. I'm looking forward to the second part of the league. Because I think I have like a good couple good decks in the format, as long as the format doesn't radically shift anytime soon. So.
Yeah, I just want to do better than losing.
That a
would
lot.
Be good. But I gotta say, I mean, this whole season, I have not found any deck that I click with. Like, nothing seems Nothing's calling my name.
I've read a lot of people saying that about Battle for Zendikar Limited.
Yeah.
And I think Standard Pauper is a reflection of Limited a lot of the time. Because you're basically playing a really good Limited deck. I understand that, actually. I just like playing Control, and it's a pretty good Control format. So.
Yeah, I mean, that's cool. But like I said, you know, just nothing's calling me. There's always one deck that I'm like, oh, I love it. And I'll play it to death, but...
There's not a good. There's not enough good blue flyers for your favorite deck.
There isn't. There's not. And I don't think they're going to print them anymore, which kind of sucks. Oh, well. Yeah, what are you going to do? Cool. All right, Mr. Dan.
Oh, yes. Well, I do have an announcement that I thought about 15 minutes before the show and that I even managed to discuss with you very briefly. In a year's time, I will, worst case, be at the end of my full-time YouTuber podcast run, depending on the success. So if I have to, like, do real work, oh, God forbid.
Please, no.
Then I would have a hard time doing what I'm doing now, that is the Pauper Gauntlet. So I put the Pauper Gauntlet Season 4 on the Patreon on the $500 level. And if we can hit that before next year, so it would be very good if you became a patron at patreon.com MagicGatheringStrat. But if we hit $500, I will be doing the Pauper Gauntlet next year. But I introduced the concept of a mini gauntlet on the Patreon just before this show. So the $225 level, which we are very close to, we have been over that level before, is the Pauper Gauntlet All-Stars. And that is what will happen in a year if the regular Pauper Gauntlet does not happen. And it will be a smaller version of the Pauper Gauntlet featuring decks from the first three seasons.
Ooh.
And I will get back, I'll give you more information next year. So I'm working on that as a concept. I'm also thinking about what next big thing I will do when the Gauntlet finishes sometimes in March, April. It will probably finish about when Game of Thrones starts. That's good. And I have time to do my podcast about Game of Thrones. But, so I'm thinking of a couple of things to do. There is, of course, the prospect of doing another Modern Bible, going really deep into another Tier 1 or Tier 2 deck in Modern. But I'm also thinking of something that I have named The Push.
The Push?
Yeah, but I can't say anything more about that right
okay.
now.
Okay, okay. Keep the mystery alive.
Yes, and now the Twitch audience got to see that my antivirus expires in 10 days. So if you want to hack me, do it in 10 days. Right. I'm probably too lazy to update.
Oh, updates. The bane of my existence.
In the middle of the Twitch screen.
Right.
So, for decks then, I've been playing the Double League as well. I lost in the Jeskai Tempo Mirror. It is a Tempo Mirror. And I really didn't know how to play that mirror. I think my opponent did. So what I did, I determined he was a bit more aggro than I was, so I went full control and tried to control him, and that didn't work. So I'm also looking forward to the next Double League round, because I did not make the top 8. I'm now doing two Modern videos a week, instead of the limited one then, after this thing with the patrons.
Right.
So I'm doing one series on the Grinding Station deck as a budget Modern deck instead of a silver black deck. So I'm crushing people with the Grinding Station deck in the Just for Fun room, and it was a lot of fun.
That Grinding Station deck is right up my alley.
Yeah, it is. It's
that's
crazy. Thing,
that's awesome.
But I'm also doing Tron videos then, so half of the time I will be doing Tron videos as long as the Grinding Station goes on, and then I will either find a new deck or do even more Tron videos. I might actually put a couple of Tron videos on Magic Gathering Strat 2 in the coming week as well. Because I feel that I need to play more Tron, otherwise I will forget about the intricate workings of the deck as I am having 78 pauper decks on my mind.
That's a lot of things to keep going up there in your old cerebellum.
Yes, I did try to, for round two, I was thinking about doing 40 minutes on the clock instead of 25 to reduce this clock stress that happens with the torture resistance decks and the really grindy decks. But if you set Magic Online to for matches for 40 minutes, you only see them if you search specifically for 40 minutes.
What?
So it's impossible to find an opponent. And that's just one other stupid thing with version 4. It didn't work that way in version 3. No, and once again, they managed to make Magic Online worse.
It's all these little stupid things. It's like, why?
Yeah, it's so amateurish, the design.
It's super frustrating.
It's horrible.
I mean, just the fact that they switched Convoking with Casting, they flipped them backwards to what they were on version 3.
Yeah.
Like, I caught that immediately, like, during the beta testing before it rolled out live, and they were like, yeah, this is what we're going to do. I'm like, that's dumb. You guys are dumb.
Did you notice the confirmed blocker thing?
Yeah.
Yeah, so if you just F2 past that, sometimes it chooses to reset the blockers.
What?
So that has happened 2 times in the first round of the Pauper Gauntlet. I block. And then I F2, F2, and then I have no blockers, and every attacker gets through.
So that's not good.
That's terrible.
No. And I have done some screaming in the Pauper Gauntlet videos about that.
And wow, that super sucks.
Decided you don't need to block.
No, so I decided not to block in 2 matches.
Oh my god. Wow. That pissed me off real bad.
Yeah, so to be sure, you have to click on OK, and you can't F2 past it.
Why not?
But most of the time F2 it works. Was
okay. Yeah, F2 should be OK. That's like, that is its option, isn't it?
Yeah.
F2 is OK.
I've also, one other thing I encountered during the Pauper Gauntlet was that some stops randomly disappeared. So I sort of didn't have a stop in a phase.
Wow.
So my second main phase, suddenly I couldn't do anything in it.
I just like how this product uses the general populace to beta test.
Yep.
That's a good call. Saves money. Well,
that does not only happen on Magic Online, though.
Right, I know.
Play a Bethesda game.
Windows does it.
Oh my god, Windows 10.
Is it good?
I like it, and I've upgraded all my systems that were on 8 to it, but yeah, it does things. It makes some decisions for you that it should not. It just assumes you want these decisions. Like my sister's computer, she just upgraded, and for no reason at all, it set the hardware profile to where that when you plug in her laptop, it sets the screen brightness to 0.
What?
Yeah, it just turns off the screen, essentially.
Nice. On the computer.
On the computer, if you plug it in, yes.
That's hilarious.
It's like,
I'm not upgrading anything from Windows until they force me.
Yeah.
Yeah, my laptop couldn't handle it.
Yeah, I changed the recording computer out earlier this year. And that came with 8, and I upgraded it to 10. But it's a beefy machine. Can handle the power. All right. Well, enough about me. Let's talk about me. What do we have? Announcements. Nothing really. I'm waiting for that second part of the Double League to start because, you know, I was such a failure in the first half. Deck updates. What do I have?
What will you be playing?
God, I have no idea. I'm going to look at... What I'm going to be doing is scouring the next few PDCs and see if anything at all makes me go, oh, I would like to play that. We'll have to see.
The first round starts tomorrow, right?
Of the...
No, it goes up Wednesday. You have to reply by midnight tomorrow.
Yeah, that's tomorrow for me. Tuesday here.
Yeah. Right. Like I said, I'm going to be scouring the PDC to see if anything...
All right.
Comes up at me. We'll see. Deck updates. Let's see. I am just about finished. I had finished earlier. I had finished Turbo Exhum, Rugtron, Pig Trinket, the new Pauper Goblins, and Azorius Kitty. I now have all the stuff for the White Weenie, Deluxikoff's White Weenie deck, minus One Soul's Attendant and two Battle Screech. The only thing holding me back to be finished with Tortured Toolbox are the three Chainer's Edicts, because my god, those are so freaking hard to get a hold of. Why are they? Why? I don't get it. But like, so no one has them.
They haven't had very many printings in paper. Online, they're all over the freaking place, but in paper. They've only been out in like one set and one theme deck or something like that.
Yeah, from the Vault 20, and I may end up just getting three from the Vault 20s to go in this deck.
Yeah,
as a sideboard option.
I had a spot from TCG Player. I had a spot a few.
Yeah, I've been trying to trade for most of this stuff.
But yeah,
I'm just gonna have to, I guess, knuckle down and buy Chainer's Edicts.
Battle Screech expensive, or are they just hard to find too?
It's just hard to find. 35 cents.
Yeah.
I mean, Chainer's Edicts aren't that much, but they're like $1.50, $2 each for the 20 from the Vault 20. And I have one from the Vault 20 that's in the Pauper Cube, so I may take it out and replace it with a kind of a janky copy. To have three of the same in the Tortured Toolbox, so whenever that gets used. Because, if you have only a one of, there's no point, it doesn't really matter the flavor. But here's the deal. Because I've created so many decks, I now own, currently, 11 Chainer's Edicts, but I need three more.
Oh my god.
Yes. Chainer's Edicts, quite popular. What's
that? It's another one. Go steal them?
He said proxy them.
Yeah.
I should, and I thought about that too, because in order to make, like, if I wanted to create one land spy just to have it in practice, you have your Lotus Petals and your Simeon Spirit Guides, which are both like $4 to $5 cards. And you have four of each, so that makes that deck super expensive. But if I just proxied it all, it wouldn't be expensive. I can just print me out some snazzy stickers, stick them on cards.
You have to make good proxies, otherwise the deck would be super confusing.
Right. No,
it's
bro.
Like, just write the name of the card on the paper and put it in
the
sleeve.
Hey, my proxies are the shit. I make good proxies.
I know. You are the proxy man.
Yeah, that's what I tried to do.
Some damaged Lotus Petals on TCG Player for $1.92.
How damaged?
Oh, who knows?
Do you get both halves?
I like these older cards from like Tempest. Everything on TCG Player is damaged or heavily played.
Oh my gosh. That's terrible. Yeah. Man, they're ground on the school's pavement.
Nope, took care of their cards back then.
No, they didn't. All right. Oh, Swag Tusk. Let's talk about that. Look, folks. Look at all these cute little planeswalkers you can buy. These are our... Damn it. These are our characters.
Stuff off their table.
Yes. They're so powerful. Just... knocking stuff left and right. But you can get your very own shirt and hoodie. You heard me. Hoodie. with any of our little characters on them. Just go to Zazzle.com/MagicGatheringStrat and you can get some of these.
How do you spell Zazzle?
ZAZZLE.com. I'm going to type it up just to make sure I didn't lie to everybody. Yep. Zazzle/MagicGatheringStrat. So there you go. You can buy these beautiful products that help support us. But also, it's just we thought they were cool. Commissioned some art. This is actual art that we own. It's beautiful. I love it. My daughter was a little upset because both the Liliana and the Nahiri one, they show too much upper thigh. She can't wear them to school.
Oh, that sucks.
Yeah. It's too bad.
Oh, well. Too much upper thigh.
Isn't that weird?
Wow. Lawyer
is telling me that those are not Liliana or Jace or something like that.
They're they're our, this is the Black Mana Lady Planeswalker.
Yes.
The White Mana Lady Planeswalker. Whatever their names are. I believe this one up here, her name is...
You can name them yourself.
Marianne. And this one's Judy. Down here.
Judy the Planeswalker.
Judy and Marianne.
So yeah, there you go. Sparky Knight in the cheerleader class.
Cheerleader class, yes. So the other one up here, Marianne, she was in pottery class. Tragic accident, not ignited her spark. So this guy over here.
Coming soon on Magic Gathering Strat, Chibi Planeswalker Origins.
Yes, Chibi. That'd be great. This dude up here had a vending machine fall on him. He became robot Planeswalker.
He became one with the vending machine.
He did. He did.
So if you do damage to him, you get a Snickers.
You tickle his tummy in the right order. Beep, boop, bop, boop. You get free snacks. All right. But one of the benefits of being the YouTube content manager is that means I get to make all kinds of crazy stuff to put on our channel. And I was quite proud of a picture I made for our latest standard set of videos for Abzan. That's right. I have flaming Anafenza riding a siege rhino.
What's wrong with standard?
Look at this. Abzan charm, Anafenza, siege rhino. Hell yeah.
Who in playtesting thought a 4/4 for 3 was a good idea? Ever. I don't understand.
Leatherback Bailoff.
They did try it in Return to Ravnica as well with the, I can't remember the name, the Celestia guy. But he still sees some play in Modern as well.
Hmm. Oh, the elephant?
Yeah.
The uncounterable, can't discard elephant?
Oh, Loxodon.
Smiter.
Oxidon Smiter, yeah, that's it.
Smiter was good. Smiter was real good.
Anafenza is real good.
It's ridiculous. If you guys didn't watch any of the TCG Player Championship,
I did not.
The finals was Abzan Aggro versus Four Color Rally.
Uh huh.
The Abzan Aggro deck just ate that Rally deck up.
Like, I'm sure it did.
Swept it in 3 games. I don't think the Rally deck did any damage in the 3rd game at all.
Wow.
It's tough when they go Warden into Pump Warden into Anafenza into stupid Siege Rhino. I mean, that's just a lot to deal with for a deck in a format with a bunch of answers, and this is not that format.
All right. Well, there you go, folks. Standard
update. Speaking about rallies, stay tuned for the Evil Allies deck in the Pauper Gauntlet, that also a surprising JPH naked deck.
Yeah, that Evil Allies was also on the bubble. for me right. buying it.
It upped the power of allies quite a bit.
Really?
Well, yes.
Huh. JPH, Jack, man, you're awesome.
Okay. I don't know how he finds these things.
His brain does not work like a normal human's brain. He's got superhuman pauper powers.
Meaning yeah. that it works better.
Yeah.
Than normal human's brain.
Like it's like Professor X compared to like a normal person. It's just not on the same level. All right, Dan. This is the part where you get to talk a lot.
All right. So we have finished week two of the Pauper Gauntlet.
Yes.
And I played a total of 49 matches.
Wow.
Which means that 29 remains for the last week. I will be playing round one until right before the next show. So some matches will like leak into week four.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, the matches that was played last week then, or this week, was Simic Oracle, somehow defeating Tortured Absan.
Crazy. I'm adding the screen capture so that the folks can see
it. I'm currently 34 wins and 15 losses.
That's really good.
That's as expected. There were some quitters, so I'm thinking that I'll win every 2 out of 3 matches.
Right.
Not counting the quitters.
That poor SOB at the mono green land destruction.
Yeah, played the land one destruction card. Decks, of course, does make people quit.
Yes. Oh well.
I think it was he that actually wrote a big message to me after the match.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and it was very polite, but the basic message was, you are an asshole playing land destruction in the Just for Fun. But it was not formulated like that at all. It was really very polite.
Oh, that's nice.
Then I played Mono Black Control, and I got matched up with the Rugtron. And the idea with building Rugtron back in 2013 by Avignon then was to defeat the Mono Black Control decks. Right. And I think it is a horrible matchup for Mono Black Control. So he got going, he got the lives for his Fangry Marauders, and there was nothing I could do.
Wow.
So Mono Black Control is in the double elimination round.
That's crazy.
Delver did not join it because it ran into Freed from the Real combo deck, and that's the kind of decks that Delver just steamrolls.
Right.
So
that match wasn't even close.
Yeah, Delver's in round 3. Delver hasn't made it very far in either of the earlier Gauntlet seasons because Delver has a lot of bad rogue matchups. And what you don't want to run into with Delver is like any Deluxecoif deck. And they're out there.
Yeah.
And then I had that really crazy White Heroes unlikely mirror match. So I played White Heroic and I ran into White Heroic. And won. Then we had another top 10 deck, Rebel Grind.
Yep.
Faced Mono Black Control and lost.
Yeah.
I
feel like it's not as good of a deck as it was in season 2.
Now I'm a bit surprised at the changes too. It's confusing.
It is.
We have a couple of top 10 decks that are facing elimination round 2, and I'll get back to that. Next deck was Cyborgs, White Weenie Metalcraft. It took on a domain deck and won 2-1.
Yep.
Even though I did make some suboptimal plays that Jack pointed out. Five color green ran into goblins, and that was a party because lone missionaries were bouncing all over the place. So goblins didn't have any way to get through. And was eventually killed by Muldrifters. After a lot of pain.
Yeah, that's just embarrassing for goblins.
Yeah, and then I have the Familiars match. Familiars, top 10 deck, everyone's favorite. One of the worst decks to watch.
Yeah, but...
It was hard to come back to Familiars after a year.
Oh, I can imagine.
Elves is a hard matchup, but then again, it isn't, because you kind of know what turn you will die, so you just have to find the combo. They can't interact with the combo too much. But I did a few suboptimal plays and lost soundly 0-2. So Familiars is also facing elimination, and there were like comments with, yes, die Familiars, die.
A lot of comments.
Right.
And then there were the Familiars players who were like, what the hell are you doing?
We never lose to Elves, Dan.
Actually, I think Elves is a super strong deck and a candidate for winning the Pauper Gauntlet, which is not yet picked in the champion competition.
Somebody People. Should pick Elves. Come Go on. Pick.
Yeah, we have a really strong Elves build this year from a winning tournament player playing Elves. Then we have the fantastic deck named the Pauper Gauntlet. And if this deck goes far, it will be super confusing.
Right.
But it did defeat Golgari Delve in the first round. It's a JPH Snake deck as well. And it looks strong. So you play Vigilance Creatures, it's a white weenie deck, and then you have Vulshock Gauntlet, which is an equipment that makes you unable to untap, and you get +4/+2. And that's a lot.
Wow.
And I had my opponent over sideboard against the Vulshock Gauntlet. So then he had like Artifact Destruction, and I didn't have any Gauntlet, so that was nice. And then we had your favorite deck, Brennon, the blue Bichinio deck.
Right. It's all
blue
flyers. Blue
creature swarm.
Yeah, that...
35 creatures or something like that.
Right. It's a crazy looking deck, but my goodness. Yeah. It won.
Delver doesn't make the cut.
Yeah, that's so insane, but...
Because there are no spells.
Right. You would never, ever flip.
And it just ran over this blue-black control deck, which was quite impressive.
Oh yeah, we had that discussion about why that blue 1/1
blueberry
flyer.
Cohort, Briarberry, yeah,
Briarberry yeah. Cohort, because it is the only flying 2-mana 2/2 that doesn't have some kind of drawback. It's crazy, but that's the way it is. The only reason I know that is because I looked forever for a replacement for Carnivorous Death Parrot in the cube. Number one, I hate everything unhinged and unglued. I cannot stand anything about those sets. They drive me insane. It's an unreasonable hatred.
It's reasonable.
I can't
stand it. It's the only Mark Rosewater podcast I skip.
Okay, I'm glad I'm with fellow haters. I can't stand it. But in there it's a Carnivorous Death Parrot. It's a 2/2 flyer for 2, but at the very beginning you have to say, "Arg, you better save a death spell for this one," which is a sentence comprised of every single gotcha word that's in the set. So if someone's playing a gotcha spell, which are the precursors to traps, you would trigger them all.
Okay.
So, but since none of those piece of crap cards are in my cube, thank God, then that parrot, you just have to say something stupid. And like I said, I looked and looked and looked for a 2-mana flying 2/2, which you would think. I mean, I've looked at all costing levels. Like, if you go up too high, the 2-mana for 2 is like, and it has some ridiculous benefit that you can't have in a pauper cube. But it's so rare.
Wow. A
blue 2-mana 2/2 flyer.
Given the power of other pauper creatures, you would imagine that you could have a 2/2 flyer for two.
Right. It's not there. I can't unless I have completely missed and failed at every search I've ever done. There's just nothing there.
I think you're right, because the go-to is the 2/1 that can't block except for flyers.
Yeah, but
that's where the design lives now.
Yep, but that's just it. Sucks, but there you go.
Wow. And then we have the champion of the pauper gauntlet, Stompy.
Face
Ragtron, and if they can't get the circle of protection, they have a lot of problems. So Stompy won 2/1.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, and then I was playing Pig Shrinker. This was a deck I was nervous about. I know there is a lot of interesting decisions in Pig Shrinker, but I faced a red-green Eldrazi ramp deck, which I would immediately have admitted to the gauntlet if it had been submitted. But it's not very nice to be an Eldrazi ramp deck if you run into 4 Crypt Rats.
Ooh.
Oh, Shrinker won that.
Yeah, I remember that. You're like, well, I will now Crypt Rat for 1 and wipe his board.
Yeah, so Pig Trinket is in round 3 as well, because only the losers go to round 2. And one of the losers was Glass Cannon Red, who faced White Weenie. And the White Weenie deck just managed to put some early blockers there, and that's not what we want to see with Glass Cannon Red.
It lost to the one thing it can't deal with. Blockers?
Blockers. Yes.
But I did get 1 win with a huge punch to the face.
Yeah, that was pretty that was pretty awesome to watch.
Yeah, and then he figured out, like, okay, I only need to have a 1/1 blocker. then I can't win.
Yeah, you had no evasiveness.
So Glass Cannon Red earned its name again. And then I played the runner-up from last season, Burn. And Burn was super powerful in the last gauntlet. And this time it faced Turbo Angler, and I realized, okay, there is a Gurmag Angler very early in the game. So what do I do? If I double bolt it, I will lose. If I don't double bolt it, I will lose.
Right.
So I was crushed by Turbo Angler. Or Angler Delver, or whatever we're going to call that deck. But they can produce a 5/5 on turn 2, and that's pretty strong. Hard to deal with for Burn.
Very strong.
Because they have the counter spells to counter the last Burn spell, so if you go to the face, it won't work. But you have that one turn chance to kill the Angler. But if you do, you waste the 2 Burn spells, so it's like, yeah. There's no way out.
And by the time you get them down, they will have another Angler out. Ready to kill you.
Yes. Then I played Tortured Madness, and I faced a Fairies deck. So not the Delver deck, but a Fairies deck. Meaning that it could spellstat the sprite for a ton. So it pretty much spellstat the sprite did all my plays.
Yeah, and they kept playing that one, that new fairy. Did you get it out there, and if you have another one like it, you get to draw a card?
Yes.
Can you imagine if it was you get to draw a card for each one you have?
Like an accumulated knowledge.
That would be pretty broken.
Oh my gosh. Yeah, that would
be way better design.
Accumulated knowledge on a stick.
Yeah.
He did manage to live the dream and attacked with the Fairy Miscreant, put a Ninja of the Deep Powers into play. Had another fairy miscreant, so you could replay the fairy and draw another card.
Oh my gosh. So I get 2 extra cards that turn with the ninja and the fairy. That's nuts.
I put 15 or 14 decks to the vote this year, and one of the winners of the vote was Green Grifters.
Yep.
And the Green Grifters earned its place in the gauntlet because it also faced Angler Delver, and somehow it won. It's like, how do you defeat the Gurmag Angler with the Green Grifters deck? Well, turns out you just have to wind some Westwood something and block it. Or just trample over it.
Right.
It's like, it's just a 5/5.
Yeah, that's wow. I think
that was one of my favorite matches this week.
Yeah, it was pretty good. I watched that video, and I was kind of shocked, but there it is, folks.
That's what Green Grifters kept doing last year. It was in the top 10 playoff, but it didn't make top 10. So I said no to the deck, because you have to be a top 10 deck to be guaranteed a spot in the next gauntlet.
Mm-hmm.
But it still made its way in because of you guys. And that was pretty good. Bugs and Pigs was a top 10 deck from last year, and the Galactic President, the Brewer, he didn't want to submit it because he thought Pig Trinket was an improvement. But I said, you don't have a choice because it's a top 10 deck, so you have to submit. And then he did, and I played a good match against Grixis Control and won 2-1. Making a ton of mistakes. And this year I actually managed to get Power T so interested that he's one of the people who has watched all the Gauntlet matches.
Yeah, I see his comments out there.
Yes, and his coaching style has always been very unforgiving.
Yeah.
So, I love it that the personal friend of mine is watching the whole Gauntlet. So... Yeah, it's fun to have him along, but he wasn't very happy about the way I played Bugs and Pigs. But I did win!
Yeah. You did.
And then we went to Suicide Black! Also a crowd favorite from the vote. And it faced the Pestilence deck and won 2-1. So Suicide Black is in round 3.
The deck that you said, the whole time you're playing, you're like, everybody's tried to make Suicide Black one, you know, be a winner, but every other color has a better monocolor strategy.
Yeah, that's a David Chaffer quote.
Yeah, there you go.
But it did survive, so it's still there. And then we have the Pauper Nightmare deck. It's a red-black control deck. It took on Delver Fiend, and that was a good matchup for it because it's packed with removal. And Delver Fiend has a pretty hard time against decks packed with removal. You just have to kill the 8 dangerous creatures, and then the deck can't do anything.
Right. You're golden after that.
Yeah, Trinket Control ran into another mid-range value deck, Bant Blink. And Trinket Control eats other mid-range decks quite well. So, that was an easy win. And then the poor Bant Blink player also ran into Red-Green Land Crusher.
Yes.
So I think actually I played the Red-Green Land Crusher deck first. And I had to promise him I was not playing Land Destruction for the second match. But both matches ended 2-0 to me. And then we had that Absan Grindhouse match, which we might have mentioned last week, because it was against Dimir Control, and it was a battle against the clock. And I won with 15 seconds left, I think.
It was...
Knocked him out. It was amazing.
Yeah. That was one of the nuttiest matches right there.
Yeah, there are a lot of perverts out there that love those matches. And I'm just filled with angst at the end of them. Like,
oh, yeah, no, man, you are, of everything in all of MTGO, the only thing that seems to drive you crazy is the clock. Like, nothing else will phase you. You know, not losing, not going up against a, you know, clearly more powerful opponent, doesn't matter. But that damn clock makes you flip your lid like nothing else.
Yeah, it's because I love to win, and I have such a big disadvantage doing videos with the clock. Because I have to talk, and it will take longer for me. So then I have to make a lot of quick decisions and look idiotic just because I know I will time out if I don't.
Hey man, I lost the whole of the last game of the standard pauper gauntlet due to time.
I remember.
Just if I hadn't talked, I would have won.
Yeah.
I only needed like 15 seconds, so yeah.
And this list is from the article I publish every Sunday on MTGO Library. So there have some matches have gone up since then, but I'm going to save them to next week.
Sounds good.
But there is a timeout loss, actually, and that has never happened in the Pauper Gauntlet before, where I lose to the clock, as I feared this year.
Oh, no.
But overall, the round one is progressing as planned, very much the estimated result. I don't know what I did in round two last year, but the round two record was crazy. I was 21-3 in round two.
Yeah.
And so it will probably be a similar amount of decks that will be in round two facing double elimination, and it will take a miracle to get them all through, but that's the goal. So the probable loss rate is around 10 decks in round two.
Hmm.
But I will do my best to repeat the miracle of round two from last year. 15 decks are facing elimination now in round two then, so far. It's Familiars, Mono Black Control, Rebel Grind, Glass Cannon Red, Burn, Tortured Madness, Living End, Rakdos Vampires, Mono Red Land Destruction, Cheaty Morph, Eggs, Blue Black Justice Control, Mono Black Land Destruction, Dragon Delve, and Sultai Delve. That's three top 10 decks and one tier 1 deck, Mono Black Control. So, yeah. Round two will be exciting. And I will do my best to finish round two in 1 week.
You are going to... you're going to drive yourself crazy doing that.
Yeah, and if I start losing, I will tilt, and then anything can happen. There is usually one round every year, which is a catastrophe, the massacre round. And last year it was round four.
Yeah. I remember... I remember
round four. It's a bloodbath.
Yeah, I remember writing many comments to the effect of, "Oh, Dan, I mean, I'm sorry, you tried."
Yeah, so I hope that is not round two, because I love to play all the decks in round three.
Right.
And I'm kind of having second thoughts about not playing the decks in round two, so I don't know how we'll do it next time, but that will be a subject for discussion when we evaluate this gauntlet. I'm also thinking about doing round three in the Just for Fun room as well, having it be single elimination still. Because I feel that I improve so much in the decks in the early rounds. So
right. Yeah, because
playing the decks, even if they don't face elimination round two, had some sort of value that we will not experience this year.
Yeah, that was... I was thinking about that too. You don't have time to practice a deck. You don't. I mean, that's not part of the gauntlet. Yeah. But round two kind of was the practice. And now that's gone.
Yeah, and it was so much fun as well, because there is no pressure then.
Right. You can play it, you know, it's already won, it's already in round three. Well, we'll have
that makes the quitter matches really worthless.
Oh, no kidding. We'll have we'll definitely have basically a whole show to Pauper Gauntlet Aftermath.
Yeah, that will be good. So did you have any favorite matches this week?
Let me think. I know I was rooting for Five Color Green, because that means at some point I'm probably going to sing that song. And I was singing it the whole time you were playing. So
Five Color Green.
Yep. I found my presentation. I'll just have to update it for today's pauper. Pauper meta, but I think I'll do that sometime before Christmas. It'll be really close to Christmas though. I have the week of Christmas and the week after off, so I'll be looking for stuff to do.
All right, well, round three will be a long one. It will go on over the holidays, and it will probably be a 4-weeker.
Wow.
One thing that makes me really sad, and it's the same in every gauntlet, is that all these brilliant decks will die except one. So it's like, I will make every brewer disappointed eventually. All I can do is just to prolong it as long as possible.
You can string out their death over a course of weeks.
Extend the pain.
And this year there is a big reward for me for getting to round 16. And if I had known when I announced this gauntlet that it would have been the league round, I would put it earlier. So that will probably happen next year. We got to round 13 last year. But that involves a deck going 13-0, pretty much.
Gosh.
Yeah. Or at least 11-0 if it doesn't have to play in round 2.
That's amazing. But yeah, there it is. All right, man. Well, that is a great update. I'm going to minimize the screen.
Perhaps we should talk about the One Land Spy match because of the title of the show.
Oh, yeah. I forgot. I got ahead of myself and put it in here.
It didn't get there.
I got there in the first duel.
Yeah, first duel was beautiful. You set yourself up. It was nice. But then...
And then I got into... I played Mono Black Control, which is a horrible matchup because they can discard your cards.
Yeah. It has interaction. It's a horrible matchup for One Land Spy.
And they could gain life.
Yes, that was the killer. And that's another thing that the original time that this was in the gauntlet was One Land Spy, because there were no gain lands in Pauper.
So yeah, they hurt a bit.
Yeah, so now you're sitting there looking at the possibility of not being able to go off until round 4 or 5, and they're already at 23. And then if Gary comes down, Lord help you.
You just scoop.
The really bad thing with this second duel done with One Land Spy was that I read the full Salvation thread before, so I spent about 30 minutes preparing, which is a lot for a Pauper Gauntlet deck, because that adds a lot of time if you have to do that every time.
Yeah.
But I know people voted this deck in because they just wanted to see me fail, and I was like, I'm not going to fail. But then I got into my head that I had to use the Bauble to get back Haunting Mystery. But right. I could have used it to get back Songs of the Damned. And I had the Bauble, and I had 5 mana, so I could go Spy, Bauble, Songs of the Damned, Morgue Theft for Simeon Spirit Guide,
yep.
Morgue Theft for Anarchist, get back Misery and win. And I had that kill. Mm-hmm. The turn before Gary landed. So I missed the kill, so I would have won the match.
Right. What is the spell that you sacrifice a creature? A spell, if it's in your graveyard, you sacrifice a creature to get that spell back.
What is that?
I'm trying to remember. I might be thinking of something different. I could have sworn that there are... What are all the accelerators you have? You have...
Lotus Petal.
Dark Ritual.
Cabal Ritual. Simeon Spirit Guide. Cabal. Tinder Wall.
Cabal Ritual.
The Elf.
Elves of Deep Shadow.
Elves of Deep Shadow.
Yeah. I could have sworn they were in my winning Nationals deck.
Oh, really? Nice.
Yeah.
Well, can
for Mind Twist.
Oh, Mind Twist. That card.
Standard Mind Twist.
All right. Okay.
Turn 2, Channel Mind Twist. So that was the thing.
That's awesome.
Yes. Actually, I have scheduled a lot of matches for next week, and there are much worse mistakes than this One Land Spy match. And I put them all in the very last hours before the next show, so as few people as possible will watch.
Dan, you're gaming the system, Dan. Mistake.
The absolutely biggest mistake will go live about 1 hour before the next show.
Oh, don't you better think I'm going to watch it now.
Where I successfully managed to wipe my own board.
Damn. Oh, boy.
I misread an unusual pauper card, and I wipe my whole board.
Kind of like when you protected yourself from Rancor.
No, way worse than that.
Oh, man, okay.
I did win when I protected myself
from Rancor. You did.
But, and the opponent's board left untouched.
Oh, no.
Wow, I'm trying to think of what card that could be. That's going to be fun to watch.
Yeah. If I tell the card, I will reveal the deck.
We'll see it.
It's an unusual card. I think it is in two decks.
Okay. Narrows it down a little bit.
So you have that to look forward to.
All right, man.
But it's all part of the pauper gauntlet.
That's what makes it crazy. That's what makes it fun.
I bet half of the audience comes to the pauper gauntlet to watch me mess up.
Don't discount that. Views are views, dude. We need eyeballs on glass is what we need.
For sure. But all the horrible play mistakes, it's much more likely to find the play mistakes on Magic Gathering Strat 2, I'll tell you that.
Yeah. All right.
So 139 subscribers compared to 5,300. If you haven't already, subscribe to Magic Gathering Strat 2 on YouTube.
Yes, it's good stuff. I watch it every day.
Also worried about MTGO tickets, the sponsor of the Pauper Gauntlet. Because I was, just a couple of days ago, I was involved in beta testing their new web shop. So what they've done is they're going to launch it this year, so it's coming at some point in December. And it worked very neatly when I tested it. So what it does is that you go in, you choose your cards, you pay with PayPal, you get a 5% discount for using PayPal. You can also pay with tickets to the bots. And then when you have done your order, you just go to the bot and get your cards without any human interaction. So it's not like MTGO traders where you have to like chat with someone and they will trade you the cards. Because the bot will just trade you the cards.
It'll just basically just straight up just give you the cards that you bought.
Yes.
Wow.
And it worked perfect during testing them. So, but they still have to get the interface a bit smoother because, not smoother, but looking better because it was a beta test.
Well, yeah. They're testing mechanics at this point.
Yeah, and I think they're still selling 10 tickets for $8. So that's an easy chance to pick up some cheap tickets.
Yes, that is awesome. That's a great value right there.
And please, if you are in human contact with MTG tickets then, which is hard because everything is automated, so for your convenience, but if you email them or talk to them somehow, mention the Pauper Gauntlet. I know some of you already have, so they are really happy with this sponsorship so far. But also follow the links in the Pauper Gauntlet videos because then they know you came from the Pauper Gauntlet.
Yeah, those links in the show notes. If you want to help us by doing nothing other than clicking, click there. That helps.
It's on top of the first link in every Pauper Gauntlet video.
Yeah.
Yeah, so please do, because this will help Season 4 happen as well. So if I could get them, or maybe I can get them to sponsor something else we do. So it's super helpful.
Sounds good to me. All right.
I think that's it for the Pauper Gauntlet this week.
Yep, that brings us to the end of the show. You know what you love it. MagicGatheringStrat.com for all your updates. YouTube/MagicGatheringStrat. Subscribe, like. We also have our sister channel, Magic Gathering Strat 2. If you want to support us because you think we are awesome, or hell, if you think we're just mediocre, patreon.com/MagicGatheringStrat. Twitter, you can follow us, get all your updates. If you follow at MagicGathStrat, that will give you the updates for all the channels.
Yeah, so you will see all the Pauper Gauntlet matches when they are published.
That is actually a great thing. If you want to see like a daily schedule, say you get off work 7-ish, whatever. If you just went to Twitter and loaded up MagicGatheringStrat and looked at the tweets, there you would see essentially a chronological order of what came out that day.
Yeah.
It's pretty awesome.
The other way of doing it is to look at the Pauper Gauntlet or the Pauper Gauntlet Season 3 playlists on MagicGatheringStrat.
Yep.
But I went through them yesterday and noticed that 5 videos were missing from the reserve channel.
Oh, really? So,
yeah, I added them, but the best source of finding the videos is definitely our Twitter.
Yes, Twitter is pretty darn reliable. If you want to follow me, it's at Cerulean Says Hi. Or Sam at SPO7677. Dan is at Dan Horning. All one word. Facebook.
Yeah, you will get some crazy ancient history and Swedish stuff as well on Twitter.
Lots of Swedish stuff.
Yeah, just follow it anyway. You'll be happy you did.
It's not a lot of Swedish stuff. It's some Swedish stuff. Maybe 10%.
I think it's fine. Facebook.com/MagicGatheringStrat. Please like and subscribe to all of our things. Makes us feel good about ourselves and actually helps us. It really does.
I think we have scared away about 20 subscribers so far from the main channel with a daily Pauper Gauntlet video. So I'm glad we didn't publish more than one a day.
Yeah, but I think also since I've started shoring up the times that we release, I think that should taper off. Because, listen, folks, for whatever reason, people don't go in and set their own email settings in YouTube. So instead of like getting a summary or no emails at all, they're getting an email every single time one of the people that they favorite publishes a video. So we have discovered that 2 emails a day is a horrible sin, and we are punished by them unsubscribing instead of them just fixing their email settings in YouTube, which you can. Everyone who's listening to this, there's a little gear icon on your YouTube screen. Click there, say no emails, 1 emails, whatever you want. I have several different dummy accounts subscribed to our various things at various settings so I can see what happens. And yeah, it's all about the settings. So just go to the settings.
I just thought of something. What happened to the weekly video schedule in this show?
Yeah. I got distracted, bored. I don't know.
Can we have it back?
Yeah, I want to do it just on one page, and Bava hadn't gotten there yet. But since the gauntlet is all on one page now, I'll probably get the weekly schedule back up to just one page.
We should mention the Christmas calendar running on MagicGatheringStrat.
Yes, Binkaby.
It's opening svenskamagic.com, their Christmas calendar with paper cards.
And guess what he sent me while we were doing the show?
The next episode.
The next episode. He's doing it daily. This breaks all my rules of publishing, but since it's so cool, I make an exception because it's Christmas. And
I'm happy that we have been able to do something for Christmas all 3 years of the channel.
Yes, I know. It's been awesome. What year was it that Bava and I did the dueling stories? I think you were doing them too.
We did the 24 decks of Christmas in the first year, and that was an interesting experience. I still recommend my December 13th thing when I explain the Swedish tradition about December 13th because it's so insane.
It brought perspective.
Yeah, we for some reason we have decided to celebrate an Italian saint on December the 13th who got burned alive. And I'm not sure why. And she's like in this white gown, surrounded by all manner of strange creatures, and we force our children to dress up like this, and it's a really big thing on December the 13th.
And this is a video on the channel?
Yeah.
Yes.
I'm going to have to search that up, because that sounds amazing.
Now,
yeah, and in 2013 when we did it, the one of the characters, I go through all the characters accompanying this Saint Lucia, the saint, on her walk, and one of them is a gingerbread or several gingerbread men.
Yeah,
but they were deemed racist because they were brown.
Oh no.
So there was a big controversy in Sweden if you were allowed to have these or not.
What other color would gingerbread be?
That's a logical argument which does not apply to this discussion. And then you have the star lads and the fire girls, and yeah, it's crazy. We have a lot of weird traditions in Sweden that survive only here.
All right. Okay. Well, it is very late. Oh. And now it is time to say goodbye to all our company. For this week, I am Brennan.
I'm Sam.
I'm Dan.
And this has been the Magic Gathering Strat Show. So quiet.
Pauper gauntlet.